Welcome to Entreprogrammers Podcast, the podcast for developpreneurs, the podcast where you get to be a fly on the wall listening to real conversations of three developers trying to tackle the challenges they face as entrepreneurs.
Trust the process, dude.
We are live, I think.
Oh, okay.
There we go. Yep. Oh, Derek's okay, wearing his shirt.
Trust the process.
I was wearing mine yesterday.
I'm not sure where mine is.
I'm wearing this shirt in honor of me really needing to believe this right now.
I'm wearing this shirt in honor of it St. Patrick's Day and my wife will pinch me.
Oh, I'm totally greenless. Oh, well.
Is it St. Patrick's Day today?
Yeah. All day. 24 hours of it.
Oh, so this week I was thinking, oh, yay, I don't have a zillion calls. But it was JS Remote Conf yesterday and the day before. So it was
a zillion calls.
Call after call. I'm so tired. I am so tired.
This is a funky placement of a webcam, I have to say.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's at the bottom. I'm on the Dell XPS 13 and it's like at the bottom.
Oh, weird.
The bottom left side.
Yeah, you have to like stare into the bottom corner of the screen. It's really odd. Yeah.
I have a new computer.
Stupid engineer somewhere decided that they wanted to make a smaller screen and then panicked because they didn't know where to put the camera.
Yeah.
Ooh, what are you showing us, Chuck?
So yeah. I was going to get a monster laptop like John's. Other one? The one that's really a desktop that moves. And I was like, I decided, you know what? I don't really want to spend $5,000 on it. And 99% of the time when I'm working, I'm right here. So I was like, why not just keep my MacBook Pro, and I'm just going to wipe it. I'm going to pull everything off it that I need, and I'm going to wipe it. And then just reinstall what I want on it because I'm having hard drive issues and things like that. And then it's not running 10 million things. And then I built this desktop machine for about $2,000. And anyway, it's got 64 gigs of RAM and an i7-7700 processor with four cores, 4.2 gigahertz. And then I have this monster video card in it. It's a gaming video card, but it has like five ports on it. Nice. Of course, they're display ports. I hadn't even seen one of those before. So I had to go buy new cords for it, but... Yeah, nice. So I'm moving everything over. Windows 10 is weirding me out a little bit, but
you get used to it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Since you guys are going all retro here, I've decided to cancel my email account, and you can reach me by fax now only.
I'm going carrier pigeon. If you don't send me a carrier pigeon, I'm not going to read it.
And I only read messages strapped to the right leg.
Mm-hmm. Left leg is for my wife, right leg is for me. Make sure you That's get right. it correct.
Yep. Right leg at carrierpigeon.com.
Hold on. Let me see if carrierpigeon.com is open.
I have my doubts. So.
Oh, it's taken.
Dang
it.
I also have to say I love having a director of operations. It's like, oh, let me take care of that for you. I was talking to her about setting up Kickstarters for the 5 minutes of JavaScript and Ruby 5 placements. And she's like, oh, I'll do that. I'll set those up. I'm like, okay. So now I just have to record videos and tell her essentially what I want the page to say.
John, your trackpad clicking is massively loud. I think you're coming through the laptop mic instead of the headset mic.
Yeah, I think so too.
That's interesting. Let me see
it. It literally sounds like you're thumping me on the head.
Yeah.
That was last week's episode.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Derick, you weren't here, but I was there. So it was pretty, it was like, I don't know, it was like the Odd Couple. John, I was standing next to John. You could see my nose and eyebrows above the screen.
Yeah. It was weird.
Nice. Does that seem like it's coming through this?
It sounds different.
Nope. John's travails with the Windows Sound Manager continue.
That's the one thing. Why doesn't Windows fix that? Come on. That, like, just let's fix that. Make it real easy to switch the source.
Like, I had to fiddle with that.
Yeah. It's been a long time. Like, come on, guys.
So Chuck, how'd the conference go?
It went really well. The speakers did a terrific job. It was funny because I had two people buy tickets yesterday, so they had missed the entire first day and most of the second day, and they were still delighted with what they got.
Wow.
So, I was pretty happy with the whole thing.
Yeah.
I shouldn't say this publicly, but you know, I put the tickets or the talks up for sale. You can buy a ticket after the fact and just get the video recordings for like half the price of the regular ticket. And so I would have refunded them half their money, but they were delighted to get access to what they had. And then, you know, they went back and they could watch the other talks.
Very cool. The live experience is actually like I'm sort of coming around to it more. So like, cause they can interact, right. Or ask questions and stuff. And I just out of like a couple days ago, I just was like, you know, I had on my list, let me try YouTube live. So I pulled out my phone and I was like, okay, turn on YouTube live. Right. And let's see if anyone actually joins the YouTube live. So as soon as I turn that sucker on, there's like 100 people. watching, right? So I was like, okay, well, maybe this is something. So then it like in within like 10 minutes it creeps up to 200 people at the live, and everyone's asking all kinds of, I turned it into an AMA, and I did it for like an hour and a half, and people were just like super like thrilled about this, like this is the best thing ever, and demanded I do more of the lives. So there's something about the live, like versus the recording. I mean, I'm making videos every day, but then the live is so much more exciting. So I think there's definitely a value there.
Yeah, John, you know, if we could do more of those too, where we just, this would be an interesting way to drive people to the YouTube channel from the list. You know, like if you just decide one day,
make an AMA.
You want to do one, you know, like we don't have to necessarily schedule them that far in advance. But or like have them at any regular interval, but we could just, you know, fire off an email one day. Hey, I'm doing an AMA in an hour on YouTube.
Yeah.
Go here and, you know, probably drive a bunch of people, a bunch of new subscribers from the email list.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Actually, a lot of people were like, hey, why did you do this at like 11 o'clock at night and not tell anyone? I was like, I'm just testing it out. People were like really hurt and offended that I didn't let them know that I was doing this and they missed out on it. And I was like, I'm just like, I'm not committing to this stuff. I'm just like doing it.
Yeah.
But, and I found out I need a moderator to.
Yeah. Yeah,
there was this one person that was on the chat, and they were like, her name was like Brielle or something. And at first, she was chatting like, she was offended, like because I was using foul language, and she was like, you need to know Christ, your Savior, and like just give me that, right? And then I don't know, I was like ignoring her, or I said something. I was like, thank you, but you know, I'll just do what I want to do. And then she was like, you're a fucking Nazi. You're a fucking Nazi. Like, so she, y'all.
Whoa, wow.
And she started calling me a cuck and all of this stuff. And I was like, I'm this is amazing. Like, if you accept Christ, or you fucking fucker.
Guarantee you that was actually not an actual woman. That was some dude being a troll.
I don't know. I don't know. Like, this person was mentally disturbed based on, like, I don't think it was just like a trolling. I think it was like someone who's mentally disturbed. But anyway, I needed a moderator there.
Mm-hmm. But YouTube Live and YouTube streaming attract the worst of the worst. If you don't have a moderator, you're going to end up with all kinds of that stuff.
Well, but it's interesting too, because people get in and they, you know, they act like they represent a particular group, and then they pull crap like that. I mean, you know, because I'm a practicing Christian, and that kind of behavior drives me absolutely up the wall.
Right? Yeah.
You know, more than anyone else, because it's like, hey, look, that's not the rest of us. You know, and you see it in all of these different groups, you know, the trolls that get out there, and it's like, I'm sorry, but you don't represent the rest of the development community or the rest of the Christian community or the rest of the, you know, whatever. But yeah,
I mean, I do go around screaming at people, yelling, "I am JavaScript. Get in line, bitch." that's right?
Converter die.
Love it.
But yeah, if we set up the other thing too is like it gets so much watch time. So I think if you did YouTube live, especially if we blasted the list and did it at a semi regular basis, even once a month, you'll get so many people watching for such a long time that it's going to boost the YouTube rankings up there quite a bit. So I think doing a few of those could actually really grow the channel just by
interesting
by that. So
plus
it's pretty much fun. I backed myself into a corner. Like someone had asked, like I was answering some questions and someone had asked about, I can't remember what it was, but somehow we got into the discussion of like, did the Nazis produce anything good at all? Like, and I was talking about we took a lot of science from we captured Nazi scientists after the war, and used that a lot in the technology that we have today. And that's like a true statement. And oh my gosh, some people were like, just went so bonkers when I said that. They're like, oh, I can't believe you're condoning Nazis. And so I had to like make a blanket statement. I was like, look, everything I've said, I just want to make this very clear. I do not support Hitler or Nazis. Okay, let's just make a clear statement. I was trying to make the point that like whatever thing that someone that you think is bad or that like is evil, like there's always like something that you can at least learn from it or some kind of positive that you can pull from it. And I said, even for example, the Nazis. And then that's where that whole thing actually never went down that road.
Yeah.
Then like, well, like how? I explained that one. And then
note to self.
Yeah.
Well, it's crazy though, because people, they totally take it to that extreme though, right? Is that, you know, there's some good technology that came out of it. You know, that doesn't mean that genocide's okay. It doesn't mean that a lot of the other things they did were okay. But, you know, yeah. But people, you have to explain that to people because they can't actually turn their own freaking brain on.
Right.
And go, oh yeah, clearly he's not saying that genocide's a good thing. Yeah. I mean, come on, folks. For heaven's sake. I mean, that's the whole thing with like on Facebook and a lot of these other areas, you know, people just go all the way out to the bitter end of reason.
Right.
And, exactly, yeah. You know, and then pulling them back in. I mean, you say the sky is blue and you're a racist, and it's just, it's dumb. It's like, come on, use your head, you know, assume good intent until it's obvious there isn't some.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
Because most people are reasonable people. Yeah.
Right. Even people that actually say stuff that is actually like pretty extreme, usually their actions are not, they're usually talk, right? Mm-hmm. So you shouldn't even really believe. So like, yeah, when you stretch it that far, it becomes kind of ridiculous. Like you can't just like ring the fire alarm every single day, right? Like, you know what I mean? Like you can't pull that sucker all the time. It's like the boy who cried wolf. It's like now you're just like this loud noise and everyone sort of ignores you because every single thing is so super offensive and so super wrong.
Well, then you just have to be louder and more frequent.
I guess so. More cowbell. Yes.
I need more cowbell.
More cowbell.
Yeah.
But yeah, I shouldn't have fallen into that trap. So I have to learn how to do the live stuff without falling into traps. So I also fell into the trap of who did you vote for, which of course I'm going to answer honestly. So then that was fine. That was not as bad of a trap. But there's definitely, definitely some traps.
Yes.
Well, that's a no-win either, right? Because half the country hates Trump and the other half of the country hated Hillary. And if you voted third party, you were a weenie. Mm-hmm. So.
That's but it was overall fun. It was overall pretty fun. I answered a lot of interesting questions. And
the ultimate then would be to combine a Reddit AMA and a YouTube AMA. That would be like crossing the streams of crazy.
Yes,
yeah. Oh, no.
That would open a portal into hell. You would have literal demons asking these questions and tormenting you.
Oh. So I do have a question about YouTube if we're going there. Because I'm gearing up to do Ruby Rants and all of these. Should I have them edited before I put them out, or should I just record a bunch and just start pushing them out?
Start with that at first. Get some traction built. Nobody cares at first. You don't need that professional intro and slick graphics and music and all that at first. Just start getting some traction. And once you get a good idea of how you want it to go, then start editing them and making them look better.
That's fair. I like that idea.
Yeah, I think you might want to do some edits, right? Depending on what you.
Yeah, I mean, if you squirrel around with your wording for 5 minutes and then say the one perfect thing at the very end, you know, edit out those 5 minutes and things like that. Yeah,
and you might want to think about. You'll eventually want to come up with a system, right? So you'll eventually want to figure out how you're going to put either you're going to put annotations, or you're going to put things on the screen, or you're going to put an end. Hard. So you'll want to start implementing those things one at a time, so it's not overwhelming. I mean, the most important thing is that if you're doing a daily video, that it's daily, that you actually are consistent. Yeah. So I would say build the consistency first.
Yeah.
Get to the point where you can, because you don't want to waste time. So like if you can't make it 2 weeks, not missing a day, then don't waste your time with it, taking it to the next level.
I would say probably titles, descriptions, keywords first.
Yeah.
Then start working on editing.
Okay. I think I can do that.
Yeah. Right.
That makes it easier too, because then I don't have as many roadblocks. I just record it. I just sit here in my chair.
Yeah.
Let people see what a mess my office is and talk to them.
YouTube is getting rid of annotations.
Yeah. They are?
I just got a message. Yep. So you have to use cards and end screens.
Yeah. End screens are better anyways.
Well, yes and no. I mean, it depends on what you're trying to do. Like with what I do with the videos now, I point to a lot of videos, right?
We
do a graphic and it says click here. And so people can click directly from the video. Uh-huh. And
the annotation has never worked on mobile anyways.
Yeah, they never worked on mobile. But what I do at the end too is I have a screen like my video shrinks down. And then it shows two more videos going and it says subscribe. And then you can click on either one of those videos. So the end screen isn't going to quite allow us to do that anymore. So we'll have to figure out. What I was thinking about was having Rodrigo keep things as similar as possible, but basically in the little things where I point to video during the video to have a card show up and just to have it say on the description, expand the card to go to the video because that will show up on mobile.
Right.
And then the same thing with the end cap. So maybe, I mean,
well, with the end screens though, you can have the end screens insert like most recent video and then suggested video and then your subscribe thing as well. And I see a lot of gaming YouTubers using a graphic that they have positioned a certain way, that the graphics are set up a certain way. And then they have the end screen bits in place in the correct spot. So that you see this beautiful graphic, but then when you hover over, you get the expanded subscribe chunk or the video that you suggested to watch, things like that. So it can be done really well and it can look really nice and be just as effective, but then it's automated by YouTube instead of you having to do it manually. All you need is that one graphic that you put in there, and then you apply your end screen template and YouTube does the rest of it.
Yeah, I mean, we had it, you know, I mean, obviously what Rodrigo was doing was much more intensive because he had to actually get the embedded videos and put them in himself, which is sort of an advantage for us. But I think overall being forced down this road will help because right now, I mean, a large percentage of our traffic is coming from mobile and those guys can't interact with the stuff anyway. They have to go to the description. So overall, they'll probably be a good thing, but it definitely messes with.
So if you have videos...
What's that?
If you have videos with annotations, will the annotations just die?
No, it'll keep them. You just won't be able to add any new ones.
Okay.
So if it's super successful, though, if we have good uptake, then we'll go back to our most popular videos probably and figure out if we can retroactively, you know, remove the annotations and add end screens.
Yeah, you can do that. I've done that before.
So the problem though is that it's like all or none. That's the whole reason why I didn't use end screens is if YouTube said, okay, you can, yeah. So that's the whole thing. Like, yeah. And that, yeah. In fact, that's why, because I knew that we weren't working on mobile, but when given the choice of having annotations or end screens and cards, it's like obvious annotations are more flexible. So, yeah.
Well, the reason I think they're better is that the end screen, the percentage of people that watch all the way to the very last second and see the end screen is going to be a lot lower. People can watch 80 or 90% of the video. If you've got three or four or five annotations in there, they're seeing multiple calls to action versus like probably only, I'd have to look, but I would guess like 20, 25% of people or less actually make it to that end screen.
Yeah.
Right. But
is extending the video for like an extra 30 seconds or longer so that you get more people hitting the end screen bits.
So you show the end screen for 30 seconds?
Yeah, but pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what we do now too. But what we're going to do is we're going to make it so that when I point to a video midstream, since there won't be an annotation, but that it'll still be the same thing as before. Yeah, the card, it'll just say click to expand the card.
Yep.
So that'll it'll have the same effect, except it'll work on mobile.
Yeah. But
at least that's what I'm thinking. But I guess, you know, we'll see what happens with it. I expected this, that this shoe was going to drop pretty soon.
Why was that? Just because they never bothered to put it. Oh, really?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, they didn't say that it was going away, but they were like saying you should use end screens in your videos.
Yeah. It became pretty apparent when I started my gaming channel. It became pretty apparent that they really don't want me to use annotations.
Okay.
I don't know why they don't just make annotations work on mobile. That's like
probably because it makes it too easy for people to leave the ecosystem. Because you can, you can send people off to another site.
Well, they still restrict you on where you can send people.
Yeah, you have to go to a verified URL. Yeah.
Are we verified, John?
Yeah. Well, Simple Programmer is, but it doesn't matter because we are able to use pretty links to go wherever we need to go. But
yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah, but I try not to go too many places anyway, just because we want to keep people on YouTube in order to that, because that's the metric that YouTube uses is total session view time. So,
I think changing subjects here, I think I'm going to have to cancel my plans to go to MicroConf.
No.
Basically, I have no money. So I've already paid for the tickets and the flight, but the hotel, between hotel and food and everything else that we would do there, that's going to be like another $1,200 that I just don't have right now. So I'm gotta see what I can do to.
You could win it.
Sell the ticket
while you're there.
Yeah, that's gonna happen.
The FedEx.
I can see if I can.
The FedEx route.
I can change my hotel room reservation. You can just stay in my room in another bed.
I honestly don't like doing that. I snore really badly and I wake up a lot. So it's
just like my wife.
Yeah, I am not a fun person to share a room with. It's.
But I mean, I'm not gonna force you, but I can pretty much guarantee you that you're not as bad as my wife, and you probably won't bother me.
All right, well, I'll think about that then. But
okay.
I'm at a point where I paid bills yesterday and I'm looking at my bank accounts, and I have in my personal bank account where I buy, you know, lunch and stuff like that when I go do things, I have like $23. And in my business account I've got, you know, $500. But I'm looking at a shit ton of credit card debt still. And with my client work still being very minimal right now. You know, I'm bringing in like $500, $800 a month from client work right now. I'm able to pay my bills with Watch Me Code, which is great. I'm not worried about paying my bills. I mean, I just paid them all yesterday, but I'm not able to pay down my credit cards. So anything I do, like going to Micro Conf, is just going to be put straight onto my credit cards, and it's just going to compound the problem. So unless I have some kind of miracle in the next couple of weeks, which is unlikely to happen, seeing as how long it takes me to do anything, then you know there's just no way that I'm going to have the money to actually go.
That stinks.
Yeah, it does.
But, yep.
It's like the one conference a year that I get to go to anymore. Really looking forward to hanging out with you guys and, you know, learning everything from MicroConf as well, but the money's just not there.
Yeah,
we'll have to come back and tell you what to do.
Yeah, it's been a huge source of frustration because I like in the last couple of weeks, I keep looking at the things that I have on Watch Me Code, like with my Docker screencasts and whatnot. And I have this little voice in the back of my head saying, what would Josh Earl do? And I can only ever seem to jump to the end result of, well, you know, if Josh was holding on to this series of screencasts, he'd probably be bringing in $2,000 or $3,000 a month off of this. So what do I need to do in order to get there? And I just keep, it's like I know where I want to be and know, I think I know how to get there, having done 70 days worth of copy hour at this point, but taking the time to actually get there seems to continue to elude me because I'm so busy just trying to stay afloat that it's hard to put in the effort to do the work so that I can start bringing in that extra income.
I think there's really not a, it's funny because I'm torn between like trying to like selfishly wanting you to come to MicroConf and giving you the best actual real advice. And I'm going to have to go with giving you the best actual real advice. So, I mean, if you're, well, how bad are you talking credit card debt?
My personal card is sitting at 18,000. My company card is sitting at just under 7.
Okay. You've pretty much got to like try and get as refunds on, don't know if you can beg for a refund on MicroConf, and you've pretty much got to see if you can get,
you could probably sell that ticket, I would imagine.
Yeah. It's either I'm going to start with begging for a refund, which I'm like 99% sure they'll say no to. That's their policy. So I'm most likely going to look for somebody to buy the ticket from me, which is going to go straight back onto the card once I get that refund.
And your refund bag, put your actual credit card numbers to debt in there. I would refund someone regardless of my policy if they told me that. So
yeah, so I'm doing things like my charitable donations are, you know, I'm not doing any charitable donations. I've canceled a lot of monthly things, you know. I've put another, you know, $400 or $500 monthly into my pocket by stopping a lot of things that I used to do. But this is the first steps in a long road to get where I need to be, basically.
Yeah. And I don't know if you can do anything with the plane tickets, but
yeah, I might be screwed on that because I prefer to buy the ticket option that allows me to cancel and get a refund, but it's so dang expensive to do that. So I typically end up not doing it. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if
you have Southwest. Is it Southwest you're flying?
No, it's American.
Okay, I'm not sure, but you might be able to beg them also. They do have the power to do it. Southwest does not give you credit.
They technically do, but the last time I was in this situation, I had 4 plane tickets to California, and my son ended up in the hospital for 3 months. And American begrudgingly, after like 3 phone calls, several emails, and my mother-in-law calling them, they begrudgingly refunded half of our ticket prices.
Yeah.
So, okay. we'll see.
Yeah, but yeah, yeah. I, as much as I'd like you to be at Micro Conf, it just, I mean, that's too much. Do you have an idea of like what caused you so much of that? Like,
oh yeah, I know where all of it went, and I know exactly how all of it happened, and a big part of huge chunks of it. There's three major chunks. There's all of the money I spent on hiring people to do work for me last year, like the marketing guy and the video editors and things like that. That was a huge chunk of it. There were some very large donations that I made to some organizations last year that do a lot of work that I want to support. And then there were basically me just, no, so there's four. So those two, the third one is recently I've had a large number of very expensive repairs, like on my car. Christmas was damaging. And then we now have a broken stove as well, which I'm not going to be able to get fixed or replaced for several months. So there's that. And then the fourth thing is basically just me not recognizing the levels of income that I had and the lifestyle that I should have dropped myself down to.
You know what I would actually, I think you should do, and this is going to sound heretical on this podcast, I think you should get a job. I think you should get a contract job, like a full-time job. You could get one easily. You can make somewhere between 50 to 100 bucks an hour. And just get a contract, you know, as a consultant job, pretty high paying. I'm sure you'll be able to find one. You know, maybe you'll even just have people reaching out to you after this call. I mean, after this goes live. And just count on doing it for 6 months and yeah, just do the Watch Me Code part time for now. I mean, because this is serious stuff. Like, I mean, you're kind of at the point where you're already, where the weight is just piling up and it's only going to get worse. I think I can't see you digging out of this with Watch Me Code at this point. And if you did that for 6 months, I mean, this is the thing I would advise. I would say get the job, like do a contract for like 6 months, get totally clear of the credit card debt. Cut up those credit cards, basically, because I mean, I don't.
Yeah, they're already sitting in a safe in my closet.
Because we already went through this once.
The safe is not good enough.
I'm not being. Yeah.
Remember Elaine's vault.
I'm not being mean, but like you've already gone through this once before, and you've proven that you can't be trusted with the credit cards. Like, just, I mean, that's just, you know, I would tell anyone the same thing. So just. And then once you're out of it and you just can't touch the credit cards, no more credit cards, only pay for things cash or, you know, with debit card, and give yourself like a 10K buffer that you've got in the bank that's emergency, that you're just never going to touch that, because that'll like, and then go back to full time doing the Watch Me Code stuff. But I mean, it'll be hell for a little bit, but I think that you're at a point where you've got enough subscriptions where you can probably figure out a maintenance mode that maybe will take you a couple hours a day to keep running Watch Me Code. And really, you know what? The biggest thing that you need to do, I think, with Watch Me Code, with your business right now anyway, is the long-term bridge building of, so what it is, it's just a grind. Like there's nothing, you're looking for an answer right now that's going to suddenly change things or make you a bunch of money. And there isn't.
That's not going to happen. No.
And that's not the best. Even if there was, like you did a fire sale, that's a temporary solution. What you really need to do is just grind out. You need to like get blog posts out, YouTube videos out, whatever it is, to start generating that traffic engine so that you've got a bunch of traffic coming in. And then, I mean, your sales stuff and your copy, maybe it's not perfect, but it's good enough. If you had traffic, you would have more money. The business would grow. So, but traffic takes a long time. You're like, you know, you need a year of solid content that you're just grinding through to, and then you'll start seeing the fruits of that. So I don't know. That's what I would advise. I think, you know, again, I hate to on Entre Programmers podcast to tell someone to get a job, but I think that'll put you in a better situation overall.
Yep. That's kind of the direction I've been leaning as well. Like I need to figure out if my one client, the healthcare network, I need to figure out if they can actually get me some consistent hours again. And if they can, you know, then I'll just stick with them. But if they can't, then I'm probably going to be looking for some other contract.
Yeah, I would suggest putting a timeline in place for that and holding yourself to it, like give them a week, or because that's a pretty big change, and you're probably if you don't you're not going to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like I still don't. So like on the credit card thing, even if all you did with it was pay your monthly bills, it is still like an escape valve. That's going to, you need the pressure right now. You need to be in the pressure cooker.
Yeah.
Of like, I mean, I know for me when I quit my job and I had, you know, we had savings and everything, but I was still like, you know, that really kept me. It was the tiger that John has talked about. Like that kept me really motivated. And knowing, like, it's an entirely different thing to know that when you hit zero, there's nothing left. Which is, you know, when you're using a debit card, that's the situation you're in. Versus like, kind of like how, just knowing that you can just count on that credit card to be there, and then you have to like think about it afterwards, like that, thinking about paying it off versus like thinking about actually being able to pay it are two completely different mindsets.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't know, like I would cut up the cards and try to switch as many bills as possible over to something where you're actually having to pay it with real money.
I've never paid bills on my credit card, not once.
So you're paying them out of on a debit card?
No, I use a Bank of America bill pay. Oh, okay. Come directly out of my checking.
I'm talking like subscription stuff. I'm talking like,
oh, okay,
Dropbox and all that stuff. Like that, yeah. Those are real expenses. Your Amazon S3 bill, like that needs to be real money, not credit card, because right. It'll. Even just switching some of that stuff over will start to ramp up the pressure.
Yeah. I see what you're saying. I was thinking when you said bills, I think mortgage, yeah. Water, electricity.
Yeah. 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 No, to me, a bill is anything, yeah. Any kind of monthly,
right.
Monthly expense or anything like that.
Right.
Yep.
One thing, Josh, one thing, you know, again, I don't want to suggest this as a solution as a like get out of jail free card either, but I'm still sticking by my original, what I just said about, yeah. My original advice, but it just occurred to me, Josh, that what do you think, like, is there a package that we could put together that we could figure out some kind of a deal to launch to our,
the send, I mean, we've got, to Micro Conf.
No. Well, yeah, kind of, maybe, like, so Derick, like you're, like if you gave us a bunch of stuff to bundle together, like courses, Watch Me Code content, I wonder if we could do some kind of thing of white label or licensing or something to launch to our audience. I guess it would depend on the results we get from this JavaScript launch we're doing now.
Yeah,
right.
But if that's popular, there might be something that we could figure out that would.
I'd be willing to think about that, and
the best option there would be Docker right now. I've got the how to learn Docker, the course. It's, you know, 12-15 screencasts or something like that, which is a in and of itself a self-contained thing. And then there's the Docker for Node developers, which is the big course, which has, you know, like 30 screencasts and the ebook and everything else.
Right.
One other thing, you know, you're talking about kind of a joint venture product. As I put on, including the one that I got done yesterday, one was JavaScript and the other one was DevOps. And there was a lot of Docker content at DevOps Remote Conf. I'm wondering if we could pitch to my list some kind of combo deal where they get all the videos from DevOps Remote Conf and your Docker content.
Yeah.
Or all the videos from JS Remote Conf and all of your JavaScript content.
Yeah.
I'm just throwing that out there as an idea.
And yeah, and these, yeah. And this is, again, I would say, like, these are like band-aids.
Yeah, yeah. Totally.
Right. So maybe we can do a little bit of band-aids.
These are band-aids to throw chunks of money at the credit cards until I can figure out.
But the ultimate solution has to. Has to be you know, something different. But yeah, I mean, these are just some things we could talk about, and I think we can actually
let's talk about it after we see. So Derick, I would say I wouldn't count on any of this stuff or like really think about much of it for the next month or two. Like for us, it would probably be two or three months out realistically, because we're doing this big JavaScript launch this week, and I don't know how that's gonna go. We're gonna see. Right. If it flies.
I've been pitching my list already on the conferences, so.
Right.
You know, they're already warmed up to it, so that might actually work here.
You could, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But anyway, we can talk about it later.
Yeah.
Damn it. Damn it, Derick. Who the hell is going to party with me at Micro Conf?
I know, man.
I'm going to have to cancel the hookers. Damn.
I'm seriously not happy about having to cancel this, but I don't.
Yeah, no, you know, no.
Four months ago, I was looking at the situation and going, okay, I have a plan to get out of this. And I did. Yeah. I was putting like $3,000, $4,000 a month onto my cards, paying them down rapidly. I paid down like $15,000 or $20,000 in 3 months at the end of 2016. And then shit just blew up, and, you know.
Yeah.
It's just.
Well, you got to do what you got to do. So, you know, do it. I mean, you can, like, it'll be, like, if you get a job and you, for 6 months, and you'll pay it all off, and you'll have a decent cushion, and then hopefully you'll never ever get into the situation again.
Yeah, I gotta stop being an idiot about this. I know exactly where all of that debt came from, and those are decisions that I have to stop making.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. When I was in college, I knew that I didn't trust myself with a credit card, so I got a Capital One card that had like a $350 limit on it.
Mm-hmm.
And they raised it to $500. I think they tried to raise it again, and I wouldn't let them. And I graduated, and that sucker was maxed out. I'm glad it wasn't a $10,000 limit. And I knew that when my wife was getting ready to quit her job so we could start having our kids, I knew that, like, I mean, I'm not reckless really, but I knew that I know for me, it's way easier to buy stuff when I don't have to make that decision or I don't have to part with that money today. So we can't, that's when we canceled all of our credit cards. It's basically when I knew when our income was going to go down. I was like, okay, so it's just super dangerous.
Yeah.
I've got to jump off at pretty much exactly the hour, because I've got an interview with Mario Tomic.
Cool.
His channel.
Where are you at?
I'm in Boise, Idaho.
Okay.
In Idaho.
Not to be confused with Iowa.
Yes.
I always have to stop. Never been to either.
Yeah. I'm doing the keynote for the Boise Code Camp. It's a huge code camp, 6,000 to 7,000 people.
Wow.
Whoa. Holy cow.
That's what someone told me yesterday. I don't know if they're right, but that's insane. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's fun. I'm going and visiting all the old places I used to visiting friends and stuff. So it's kind of cool.
Nice.
But, tonight, or it'll be tomorrow morning, I'm doing the talk, and then I'm flying out to San Francisco on Sunday. So, well, should we do thoughts?
Yeah, now that I've killed the mood.
That's okay. I wasn't going to kiss you anyway.
I'll start this time. I've got mine. So my thought for the week would be to let go. And what I mean by that
let
is
go,
to
let it yes, go.
To let it go. To let go of everything. To be basically willing to let go of anything in your life. And like to have that attitude instead of trying to control and hold on to things tightly, to be willing to have anything, whether it be finances, relationships, whatever it is, be free, essentially, like to not hold on to things. Cause I find that, you can't really control most of those things anyway. And the more that you try to hold them, and the more that you try to control them, the more misery you bring on yourself. It's the thing that causes you stress. And it really comes from trying to find things from external, right? It's like when you're holding on to things, it's because it's a lack of self-reliance and self-sufficiency and self-esteem. And when you're able to let go of everything, it builds yourself. It's the ultimate reliance on yourself, because you know that no matter what happens, whatever circumstance in your life, that you don't need something external. You don't have to hold on to things and force things to go your way and control people and circumstances, because all that you need, you already possess. So it's a mindset. It's a continual mindset, but it's something I've been thinking about a lot, just especially as I'm here in Boise, and as I was going for a run yesterday, I've run past places where there's still stuff. Like there's like an emotional connection for me that I haven't let go of some things. And so I was just, as I was running by, and I was like, it's almost like there's a psychic weight. And I was like, wow, okay. There's some stuff. Like I've done pretty good in my life with letting go of things. And it's really helped me a lot as a person, and just as my ability to enjoy and feel fulfilled in life. But there's still areas, and we all have areas where we're holding on to things. We're afraid to lose things. We're, the fear of loss, where we're just trying to control things and worry about what other people are doing. And the more that you let go of that, the more freeing it is. So yeah, that's my thought.
I'll piggyback off of that to some extent. So, one thing that John said, going back to that YouTube annotations thing we were talking about. There was a chat yesterday with Rodrigo and John, and I was kind of eavesdropping on it. And Rodrigo's like his hair's on fire, right? Because like they're taking away his annotations. And I mean, for one thing, he bills us a lot of hours for putting those annotations on there. So so that's like it's kind of freaky for him. A little bit of his income, is potentially at stake. But John said, challenge equals opportunity. And I hate this about John, because every time I want to complain about something that's happening or he's always trying to find the opportunity in it, but it's totally the right mindset. We're having this conversation, in San Diego as well. So there was a session at the, traffic and conversion about this new thing that Google's rolling out called AMP, which is, basically it's a different format. So you offer your blog posts in a different format, and then Google and Facebook will like pre-cache them. And
hate Google AMP.
I hate it as well, but they are ranking now. They're using AMP pages as a ranking signal. So you'll see, there might be a better page, but if there's an AMP version of a crappier page, you're going to get that most likely. And it was really making me frustrated, because Google's found yet another way to make my job harder, because I can't show pop-ups on an AMP page. So they're going to downrank our pages and show these mobile friendly ones that I can't do anything. I can't do as much with those visitors. And so I was kind of ranting about this, and John's trying to figure out how this is going to work to our advantage. And that is really, it can be a little frustrating when you want to vent, but it's really the right mindset. And cause you can't stop that change. I mean, Google is a behemoth. They're going to do what they're going to do. And you just have, the winners will be the people who figure out how to capitalize on that change while everybody else is doing what I want to do. So challenge equals opportunity.
Or as an eccentric billionaire that I used to work for often says, seek adversity, the lines are shorter.
Love it.
I like that, yeah.
Yep.
So my thought for the week will be, don't be Derick. And yeah.
But we love Derick.
Chuck.
That's the whole thought.
That's it.
So my thought is basically, let me back up a little bit, and it sort of relates to John's, but not really. On Monday I had a call with my mastermind group for, my business coach stuff, and she's out of town. So she had somebody else fill in, and his name's Matthew, I think, and he runs, a small business festival in Austin. And so we were talking about sponsorships, because that's kind of the big thing for me right now, the sponsorships and the conferences. And then just getting this funnel in place. Yeah, I only have about 10 million things going on. So we start talking about sponsorships, and you know, he looks at all the information I have, and then he basically tells me that I'm doing it wrong. And he essentially says, look, he says, you're chasing all these small fish. And if you go after the big fish, then A, they're easier to land, and B, you're going to they care about different things, and so you're able to sell them in a different way. And then he basically told me how to approach them. So we're talking big fish like Dell or Microsoft or Google, you know, as sponsors for the podcasts. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, this is what I tell people to do to go find a job. You know, he's basically spelling out to me the product that I'm building for people who are looking for a better job. Yeah. But the thing is that two things kind of came out of that I want to highlight. One of them is, A, you probably know more than you think. And B, sometimes you just need somebody to point it out to you. Exactly. So that's kind of my thought is, go out there, talk to people. I mean, that's what the masterminds are for, right? You talk to people who are invested in you and care about you and care about what you're doing. And once you have that, then yeah, start asking the hard questions, the questions that you think you already have the answers to, and see if you can learn something new. So yeah, next week I'm going to be tracking down / stalking people who work in marketing departments across some of these larger companies. And I'm also looking at attending some of these bigger events. So I missed South by Southwest, but there are a few others that I'm thinking about going to. And yeah, just basically trying to put myself in a position to get to know the people in those companies who are organizing these events and see if I can get them to organize a sponsorship of my shows.
Great idea. Love
awesome.
But that's the other thing is go big. It's kind of freaking me out thinking about going after some of these companies, but that level of uncomfortable, that's where I'm supposed to be, I think.
Yep. Yeah. That's fantastic.
All right, ladies and gents.
All righty.
I've got to go, and it's been nice. We'll see you next week.
Yeah, when you got to go, you got to go.
All right.
All right.
Want to start a business, but you just know how to code. Listen to John, Josh, and Derick as we figure it out. We are the Entre Programmers, and we'll teach you straight up to be developpreneurs.